Hey you guys, it's Brit. Today I wanted to bring to you something a little different than what I normally cover. I want to talk about this P. Diddy and Cassie lawsuit. Cassie has decided to file a lawsuit against Sean P. Diddy Combs, and it is layered and complex, and it might be triggering for some of y'all. So we're gonna talk about things that have to do with SA and DV and substance use. So, if any of those are triggering, I completely understand. Please skip this video and check out another one. But if you are interested, please keep watching. Hey guys, quick update. As quickly as this lawsuit was filed by Cassie, it's also been now settled by Diddy, but we're gonna go over it anyway. All right, you guys, so please keep in mind, I am not a lawyer, I'm not an attorney, I don't work in the legal field, but I am an opinionated person that covers things that are happening on the internet and pop culture sometimes. So today is one of those days, and this is 35 pages of the most wild, tragic situations that Cassie lived through, allegedly at the hands of P. Diddy. I think that we all know that a lot of bad and awful things happen in Hollywood. People in power get away with so many things for so many years. Eventually, most things that are done in the dark come to light, and I think that's one of these moments. Either way, let's just start at the top. This is a 35-page lawsuit that was filed by Cassandra Ventura, which is also, she's also known as Cassie. I'm sure that many of you know exactly who she is, and I'm sure that most of you know who Diddy is. So it starts out by explaining the fact that when they initially met, Cassie was 19 and Diddy was 37. Let's hit on age gap relationships for just a quick second. I'm not usually one to shame people who are in an age gap relationship. Like, if y'all are happy and you're both consenting adults, I think that people should be able to do what they want to do. But with this specific situation, it seems as though there was power and control and an imbalance there from very early on. And it's unfortunate because Cassie is somebody who, is in the music industry and obviously is, was back at that time, I imagine, really striving to be as big as she could be and to be in a relationship with somebody who is was very powerful at that moment in time. There's already a power imbalance, but nevertheless, he was 37, she was 19. So Cassie, when she was 19 and she met Diddy, she was in a relationship with somebody else, and at that time, Diddy was actually with his former partner Kim Porter, who Kim, I feel absolutely awful for. She is no longer with us. If you know who she is, I'm sure you also know that she unfortunately has passed away. But I think that she had so many things that she could have said and knowledge that she could have brought to the public as far as who Diddy is behind closed doors. And it's just really sad because I think a lot of those secrets went with her. So allegedly what happened is, they meet when she's 19. On her 21st birthday, Diddy pulls her into a bathroom and forcibly kisses her. And she cried about it, which automatically goes to tell you that it was obviously not a consensual exchange that they had. After that exchange that Cassie cried about and was upset because obviously it was not something that she wanted to participate in, he continues to pursue her. And then we go to 2007, where Diddy allegedly picked Cassie up from where she was living and gave her a pill. She later found out that this pill was ecstasy. And here's my thing again. Like, I'm not shaming anybody who wants to partake in activities, but if you're taking something like this at somebody else's request, which is what she is alleging in this lawsuit, that that's not cool. I'm not here for that. I am here for people doing what they want to do, not taking something because somebody tells them to, especially when there's already this power imbalance, this big age gap, and an uncomfortable exchange happened at her 21st birthday. Things are just off to a really bad start. It also goes over this trip that she took to Miami where they, you know, it's being alleged that they did a lot of drugs during this trip. Was also their first encounter, their first sexual encounter between Cassie and Diddy. So right after this exchange in Miami where they had their first encounter, 2008 is when Diddy decided to introduce Cassie to opiates. And that again is something, you're taking it because somebody else is telling you to take it. You're not taking it because it's something that you as a consenting adult want to participate in. It just seems like this long pattern of him telling people what to do and they automatically do it because he is older than them, more powerful than them, has more money than them, has more fame than them. And he uses that power imbalance to just get people to do what he wants to do. And unfortunately, Cassie was part of what he had left behind. It's also alleged in this lawsuit that Diddy would often have prescription medications and, you know, prescription painkillers kind of sitting out in the open as if they were candy or, you know, a bowl of nuts. Instead, it was just prescription pills. It is alleged also that he himself was, or could still be, is to opiates and would also partake quite often in taking ecstasy, which is, you know, you're a consenting adult, you're doing what you want to do. Why are you expecting everybody around you to partake in the same things that you're partaking in? This is a really alarming part to me. It's alleged that Cassie's medical information, her patient records, were being sent to Diddy's email address. Somebody needs to figure out which doctors or nurses or health providers were doing this, because that is a major HIPAA violation. And why were they not being sent to her, the patient, instead being sent to somebody? Like, she wasn't even married to this man. Cassie says that she was having some issues with memory loss, and it is assumed to be most likely from her partaking in this drug use and or head injury from Diddy and his DV that he was making her a victim of. Like, I just can't even imagine the amount of trauma that some people go through in their lives is just heartbreaking. Like, how do you keep going? I feel so awful for some people. Along with the medical records, obviously, that also included things like MRI scans, MRI results, things along those lines, they were being sent directly to his email address. You know, as this continues to unfold, I want to know, like, were they being sent to her as well? Why were they being sent to him? That is a huge problem that I took from what I've been consuming about this. You know, he's the CEO of the label that Cassie is signed to. He would constantly flaunt large, you know, wads of cash and basically, like, flex his wealth on her. You know, he was also basically her boss, even though they were in a relationship. Very, very tangled situation. He was doing things like paying for their vacations, paying for the apartment that she was living at. So unfortunately, he was controlling a lot of her life, and that's including pressuring her to allegedly partake in, you know, taking these substances and being her boss and her boyfriend with an age gap. Aside from him controlling basically every aspect of her life, it's also alleged that he would ask her to carry his weapons in her handbag, and, you know, they would be going somewhere and she would have weapons for him in her handbag, And that's a whole issue on itself or within itself, because you're sitting there and like it's on your person, but it's literally the person that's controlling your life asking you to carry these weapons around. There are many allegations of Diddy becoming physically violent with Cassie, and the bruises that she would have because of, his alleged actions, he would force her to cover them up or, make sure that they were not seen until they were, like, allow them to heal before anybody sees you kind of situation. Some of these acts allegedly happened in front of staff or security for Diddy, and not one person stepped in to stop him from what he was doing to her, and not one person stepped up to say, "This has to end. Like, why are you doing this? I'm going to call the authorities." I think that really speaks to, again, like, he was controlling not only Cassie, but all of these other people, where he had all of these people on his payroll, most likely had all of them sign NDAs, and he ran the show. He did what he wanted to do, and other people did what he wanted them to do because he was in full control. This is the problem. You give people so much power and control and money, and sometimes it creates monsters. Not all the time, but sometimes it does. The lawsuit also outlines something called freak-offs, or FOs as it was abbreviated, and these would take place at hotels all around the country, multiple different states, and that's why trafficking is mentioned in this lawsuit, because, Cassie would be forced to partake in activities with other people while Diddy would allegedly sit there and watch. And because these would happen in hotels in multiple different states, that's exactly why the trafficking is mentioned in this lawsuit. He would call these FOs their little secret, and I just think that that's demented and sick. I don't understand, who on earth would find that entertaining or pleasuring or anything along those lines? I think Diddy is such a twisted, twisted man, and he had so many people under his control for a long time. I'm glad that this stuff is coming out. And anybody who comes forth that had ties to Diddy and has a story about him, I think they're going to be able to speak up now and have a lot of people on their side. Some of these FOs were also filmed, and Cassie would delete or want to delete the footage, and Diddy would just simply say, "I always have access to these devices and everything that has ever been on them." Again, just intimidation, control. You're basically pimping out your girlfriend at drug-fueled FOs and filming it and then saying that you're always going to have access to this footage. What a sicko. This also goes over, so many different incidents of DV between Diddy and Cassie, and it also mentions how she started to get close to Kid Cudi, who is a fellow musician, and Diddy found out about this and put a like a corkscrew between his fingers and lunged at her. All because what things were no longer going his way. Speaking of Kid Cudi, it's also alleged that Diddy was going to blow up Kid Cudi's car. It has been released that a spokesperson for Kid Cudi confirmed Cassie's account. This is all true. And after Diddy saying that he wanted to blow up Kid Cudi's car, Kid Cudi's car actually did blow up in his driveway. So how do you explain that? How do you explain somebody saying, "I'm going to do this," and then this happening, and that person not being fully investigated by the FBI, the sheriff's office, the local police? Like, how does that happen? Money, power, control. Cassie obviously, continued to push Diddy away, and she has gone on to have her own children and work through all of these things that allegedly happen at Diddy's hand, including things to do with the substance use and just all of the trauma that she had to endure because of this very weak little man who had the ego the size of this universe and more money than he knew what to do with, and more people under his control than anyone could ever imagine. And not one of them stood up to defend her. So many people are now, kind of recalling into question, because this was already being discussed after Kim Porter died, but her mysterious death. There have been many unanswered questions that surround her passing and like how it happened, when it happened, why it happened. Many, many questions, many concerns, and she was going to publish a book and then she mysteriously died. I think a lot more is going to come out about this, and I want to make it very clear. When so many people have similar experiences with somebody, that's usually not something to ignore. And I want to make this clear because I remember when I was covering the Johnny Sylvester and Joshua David Evans situation, I took issue with just the lack of proof that Johnny was presenting and the things that he was saying, and then, everything fell apart from there. I would have been more willing to believe Johnny if there were tons of other people that had similar situations than he did. Then it might have been something to look at twice. And there have just been way too many people to come out and say that Diddy is a gross monster, especially behind closed doors. And I think that right now the public should choose to believe people that have similar stories to who Diddy is allegedly behind closed doors, because I think this guy is a monster, and I think all of the skeletons are just falling out of his closet right now, and I think it's going to continue to get much worse. There are going to be more stories to add to this kind of catalog of just gross toxicity, fame, money, and power, and I'm going to keep an eye on it. But that's going to be enough for today. So if you like the video, please leave a like and a comment. And if you'd like to see more from me in the future, please subscribe. I'll see you guys soon. Bye.